now watching Drapetomania. You are now watching Drapetomania.
The cult of personality. I know your anger, I know your dreams. I've been everything you wanna be. Oh, I'm the cult of personality.
Bro, I'ma give it to you with no trivia. Roll like cocaine straight from Bolivia. My hip hop will rock and shock the nation like the Emancipation Proclamation. Weak MCs approach with slang that's dead. Them eyes are running to the wall and bang your head. I push a force, my force you're doubting. I'm making devils cower to the Caucasus Mountains.
Now, if we do want to live a thug life and a gangster life and all of that, okay, so stop being cowards and let's have a revolution. But sure, we don't want to do that. Dudes just want to live a character. They want to be cartoons. Mm-hmm. But if they really wanted to do something, they was that tough, all right, let's start our own country. Let's start a revolution. Let's get out of here. Let's do something. But they don't want to do that.
At first, I didn't understand none of that because I wanted to be that gangster shit. You know what I'm saying? The silliest thing ever, man. That's what happened to us. We get cloudy. You know, I learned now that the shit that I played out there, just a fucking character, man. That's the funny shit, man. You know what I'm saying? Niggas say I'm gangster or they gangster. You know, just a character, man. You know what I'm saying? In a game that don't have no rules. Motherfuckers say, it ain't no rules in this shit, man. No matter what a motherfucker tell you, it is no rules, man. It's what you make it. Fuck them streets. You know what I'm saying? And I had to wake up and understand that. I didn't at first. And here it is. I sat in here, you know what I mean? I sat in here right now. I've been down, what, maybe 3 years, 4 years right now. And motherfuckers already vanished, you know what I'm saying? From bitches and niggas, you know what I mean? The same motherfuckers who was always had their hand out, laughing in your face and all that, yeah, you my nigga shot, you know what I'm saying? Or a bitch, I love you to death and all this other shit, they roll out. You know what I'm saying? The streets what? We ain't nothing but memories. Me, all them other niggas who talk that real shit, you ain't nothing but a memory. And I don't give a fuck what type of memory you are, you just a memory. You know what I'm saying? And as time go on, your girl leave, you know what I'm saying? Your mother leave, your sister, brothers leave. You know what I mean? Less letters, less visits, less phone calls.
Hey, let's walk this way.
Is that Prince or King? Come here, Prince. What's today's mathematics?
Hey, yo, no disrespect, but we ain't in all of that, son.
Build, destroy. To build is to elevate the mentalities of self and those around self. To add positive energy to every nation. To build, you must first start from the root, which is the knowledge foundation, and add on to the highest peak. To destroy is to eliminate and destroy any and all negativity that enters my cipher of supreme harmony.
Peace, God.
Peace, God.
Come on, son.
And I made my decision already, and I'm standing on it.
To read a follow-up on that, do you feel any more pressure to change your stance because Kevin's going to be out potentially for a couple months, and the team needs you?
See, that's what I feel like ends up coming into a lot of this culture of basketball and sports and entertainment is you bring in the team and you bring in situations that we're in, and Kev's going to heal. Kev's gonna be okay, you know, and we're gonna have to deal with that as his teammates. But in terms of where I am with my life outside of this, I stay rooted in my decision, and that's just what it is. You know, it's not going to be swayed just because of one thing in this NBA life that somehow is, you know, somehow it's brought to my attention as being more important than what's going on in the real world. It's just not happening for me, you know. And I respect everyone else's decision. I'm not going to ever try to convince anyone of anything or any of that. I just am standing rooted in what I believe in. And though we're dealing with this right now with Kev, I just know that I'm protected by the organization. I'm protected by my teammates. I'm protected by all the doctors I've talked to. And, you know, I just stand rooted.
Just to be clear, do you think
there's Nick, anything? We got one last one. We got Michael Grady.
Do you think there's anything that would sway your decision?
What do you mean?
To get this shot.
Why do you keep asking me that?
Because that's what everybody wants to know.
Who's everybody?
There are millions of basketball fans out there.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like,
who want to know if you're going to take
the chance
to be able to play at home.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Basketball fans.
But there are like, they're forget basketball fans. There are millions.
Yeah, but this is like, that's what I'm saying. You're bringing like my vaccination status into a basketball game, and it's like I live my life majority of the time when I'm away from this. So when I say I'm not getting vaccinated and I'm making a choice with my life, somehow it gets mixed into, well, what about basketball stuff? It's like, no, bro. Like, we live in a real world. This is great to be able to do this. I'm grateful for the opportunity. I love being with my teammates. I love playing on the Nets. But I've already been away enough time to think about this, to process it, to be able to make this decision, stand strong, understand that people are going to agree and some people are going to disagree. The circumstances that are at hand, I'm praying that they get changed and we're able to do things differently. And that's not just for me. That's for all those that are dealing with being unvaccinated and getting fired from work on a day-to-day basis. It's not just about me. That's been my message this whole time. So though I feel your feeling and emotion asking that question, it's just like sometimes it feels a little disrespectful. Like, I'm not just a basketball player, bro. I'm not. Millions of fans. I appreciate all of it, but it's not just about the game.
But you're one of the most famous unvaccinated people in the country. I
mean, that sounds crazy to me.
But that's the reality, though. You are one of the most famous people in the country. Most high.
But I'm not the only one.
No, you're not. I'm just.
That's what I'm saying. Fame is socially created, bro. I'm not. I hear what you're saying. Like, being the most famous unvaccinated player. What does that even mean?
Well, in the short
I don't even know what that means in my life.
This doesn't give you control.
We can't all.
This gives you no power. It just makes you look stupid. And I'm gonna ruin you as a lawyer. You'll never be a lawyer again. I bet you. I'm gonna make you famous. I'm just giving you rope to hang yourself. You're gonna be in a whole nother courtroom, in a whole nother place,
Dane, please,
for your frivolous lawsuits.
Dane, any texts that we've received,
I sent them.
We've produced. They're all in the Google Drive.
Probably can't
Mr.
read.
Mr. Lushan, you were very aware.
The testimony.
I think I did send those texts. That's it.
Hold on 1 second. I'm speaking now. Okay. The testimony is reflected in the transcript. The accurate testimony.
Disgusting, okay. With yourself.
And to the extent that there is something that reflects that that haven't been produced, we will produce that. Where are you going?
You make me sick.
Where are you going?
Sick. I don't care about that self-preservation.
Okay.
I don't give a fuck about this culture. You suck.
Just
put a whole put his whole body. He'll sell his whole culture out for a dollar.
Dane, please, just suck. Let him ask the questions. Let's give him the answers.
Just have some white man try to rob me. Suck.
All right, there's no question pending.
That ain't funny. You should be disgusted. You represent everything that's terrible about our whole community, man. And I'm going to make sure the world
knows. Can we go off the record for a second?
No, we cannot.
I want the people to know how disgusted I am.
Okay.
I'm human, bro. I get people like this try to rob me every day with a straight face. And they don't care about the culture. They only care about themselves.
I'm asking a question. I'm just...
My mistake.
Oh, your mistake. So she was not present?
Nah, not her. No. I just said my mistake. I ain't saying it again.
Do you frequently make mistakes, Mr.
Always. I make mistakes. Everyone makes mistakes. I'm human. Mm-hmm. Silly. That's not going to go anywhere in court.
Do you make mistakes? I just got him there. He made a mistake.
He's a clown.
We're going to get him on a technicality. He won't be able to come because of a warrant, so I'll do it in New York. And now I'm right in front of you, sweating like a clown. Scared. Look at you all mumbly. Look at you jittery. Look at you jittery.
Dane, please.
We got
please,
it.
Please, yeah. Please.
We got
please.
It. Okay. You said it already. Let's you know go. What happens? My triggers are when you ask me a question more than once. So if you tell me something more than once, that's when I'm interrupting.
So
period. That's what's happening.
So allow me to
wait, stop. Let me just say something. The only time I'm interrupting him is when he asks me a question more than once. So when he asks me the same question, that's when I stop him. You get the first question. So, oh yeah.
Hello? We're still on the record.
Sorry.
Give me Carlos Miller.
Boy, if you don't get your goddamn, stay out of my room, boy. If you don't get your goddamn, I got fired from Wildin' Out and had to go on the Breakfast Club to pay for my job ass back up. Ooh. Boy, if you don't get your goddamn stupid shoes, no moves, extra tight, extra white, looking ass the up out of here. If you don't get your goddamn, I look so much like a junkie, my blood type is heroin ass out of here. Boy, if you don't get your goddamn, I'm on the poster for goddamn herpes looking ass up out of here. Hey, wait, it's give me a high five for that herpes joke. I thought that was...
Hell no, look at them. White people looking for something else to steal from the black man.
I need to give these white people a chance to redeem themselves. Give me Maddie. Maddie, I need you here. Yes.
Oh my God, DC, nice outfit. I guess they renamed the show Wild and Out of the Closet.
Boy, first of all, your ass built like the last drop of the toothpaste. Hold on, wait a minute.
If we were in a relationship, I'd be the man, all right? Walking into his car saying, hey, text me when you get home.
Stay in your lane, okay? You white people don't listen. Stay in your lane.
Damn sure don't listen. You know what your ass built like?
Yeah.
A wet french fry, ugly ass girl.
Okay.
You hate biscuits, ugly ass girl. But you love mayonnaise.
Okay, I do, I do. Okay, hold on, I got one more.
No, I got one more.
Let me do one more. All right. I have
Can I say one more thing?
No.
I have one more thing.
Please.
He's ugly.
Salt and pepper ain't seasoned.
No, Sam, but this is the real problem. And I'm happy this is here. I'm happy this happened to be here. This is the real problem. Niggas never heard this sound before. You know what I'm saying? You hear that? That sound right there make your day better, nigga. That sound right there make your day better. Stop worrying about me, nigga. Get your life together and get some Just For Men and get that fucking gray out your beard, nigga. Fuck out of here.
I thought, you know, I never knew white boys had all this swag all of a sudden.
Yeah,
well. I got homies in the feds. I got homies doing life.
I'm sorry, I'm just fucking with you. That's funny to me, sorry.
Picture me rolling in the 8 series. They wanna see me take an L, I keep a K near me. Cause I'm trying to see it, I had to grow this shit myself. Back against the wall, 10 toes on the pavement. On the Grammy, the dog, then folded at a Raymond. You trying to get your likes up, you need to get your life up. Drip the Prada on an off day, promoters know the price up. Royalty in my region, all these sold out venues. Look at just to see me rhyme some words about the shit that I've been through. Blind. Front line, I seen the evil that many. For that shit, like mama told me love yourself, don't let opinions offend you. Turn your weaknesses to strength before they use them against you.
From day one, I wanted to be black. They thought I was no good, they thought I was a hack. A lot of people, a lot of times, said some hurtful things. I'm gonna make them take a bag and then scream. At the top of my lungs, I know I'm white, yo. But I'm taking the plunge into fortified territory. Cause black seems more fun. Gotta blend in, earn my homies respect. Gotta constantly keep my crack of vernacular in check, you see. Cause if I don't, they're gonna notice me. They're gonna notice that I'm white and pasty as can be. I've been working on my walk, I'm working on my talk. I'm grabbing at my crotch and limping around and spitting on the sidewalk. But most of all, I've been walking tall, hey, hey. I'm gonna infiltrate the urban underground. I'm gonna set him up and I'll knock him down. They're gonna be so impressed with me that they're gonna forget and overlook the irony. I might be white to the naked eye, but I'm gonna be black to the day I die. I might be white to the naked eye, but I'm gonna be black to the day I die. Oh, wicked, please, I don't think you understand. I wanna be black more than anything. Oh, wicked, please, I don't think you understand. I wanna be black more than anything. Oh, wicked, please, I don't think you understand. I wanna be black more than anything. Oh, wicked, please, I don't think you understand. I'm gonna act black cause I don't give a damn.
All right, when I first, you know, started rolling with my brother, you know, I was doing security. I was in charge of security back then, you know. And I was real proud, you know, to what my brother had accomplished. So to go from that, to go from the apartment to the house in Long Island to, you know, having this brother that became a star, you know what I'm saying? And knowing that, you know, when we was growing up, they didn't have all these channels on TV. You know, you only had a couple of channels. So it was unfathomable that he would even become a star. But he did. And I was mad proud of my brother, man. Well, first of all, when we was kids, right, I'm the older brother. So, you know, I put it to you like this. I found out that I could whip a lot of motherfuckers' ass that I didn't think I could whip, because they stepped to him. You know what I'm saying? It was guys who I was afraid of, but I've always been more afraid of my moms and shit. So I was like, you know, I don't care if you are a big butchie, I got to do you, because if I go home, my little brother's messed up, And my mother said, well, what did you do? I better be messed up worse than him. You know what I'm saying? My mother was the type, when we in Brooklyn, hang the belt out the window and say, either you whip his ass or I'm gonna whip your ass. Which means the only thing that was acceptable was victory, man. You know, that was the only thing acceptable. I can remember what my brother was doing before I even started working for him. And he was just doing comedy, and he would go and he would do like a high school, or he would go do Hofstra University, or, you know, little sets he was doing around the area. And the ability to go in front of an audience and express yourself and make them laugh, you know what I'm saying? That was like really amazing to me, that he had that power, you know, to stand in front of a group of people and say, this is what I think is funny, and I'm gonna make you laugh, and do it. But because he was so good at it, and I was so proud of him, I was like, real. If you didn't laugh, I was real emotional. I probably would fuck you up for not laughing. That's how I felt, because I felt that everybody should be laughing, because I thought it was funny. You know what I'm saying? Everybody else is laughing, but there's always that one hater, that one person that's not gonna go with the flow, that's gonna try to throw an egg on the show and all that. And I would always react to that person, you know. And it was all stemming from, that's my brother, man. I'm not having it. I was to the point where, man, if I went to a show and you was that hater in the audience, that was, that shit wasn't fun. Jamming you, man. Because the shit was funny. You know, if it's 10,000 people laughing, and you that one joker that want to try to squeeze lemon, fuck you. I don't even want you to be here. When I started working for my brother, you know, as security, that was the reason that ultimately led to me not being able to perform that task for him anymore, because I was the hothead security guard. To be a security guard, you have to be, you have to separate yourself from the person and do a job, a professional job. You can't be reacting to everything you hear or insults or slurs that somebody, and if you're a celebrity, you know, and especially if my brother was a young, male, you know what I'm saying, women was on him. I mean, I remember walking through the club, man. We used to go in the club and drain it. He used to drain the club, man. Just walk in and go like this. Walk, do a lap, walk out. All the girls in the club would leave wherever he was going. You know what I'm saying? And so the guys are going to be saying shit that, you know, fuck that motherfucker, man. Shit. I got money too, nigga. Nigga pull out, you know, this little knot, whatever. That happened a lot. And I used to always react to cats like that, you know? Soon as they do that, I'll be like, what? Bob! Now I'm rolling on the ground with this motherfucker. Fuck that motherfucker, man. Shit. Punk ass nigga. I have to react to that. You know? And it was to the extreme with me, where they knew this is what led them to saying, you know what, Charlie, maybe you should perform a different job in the operation here, because, you know, you overreacting, man. You reacting to too much shit. You know, and eventually you're going to do something bad, man. You're going to jump on, you know, a midget or a baby or something, man. You just, whoever say something, you know. I almost gave this old man a heart attack on the plane, because he asked us, well, we're a basketball team. And, you know, I took that personal. You know, this was an old white man, and we was in first class. And my man was, I mean, he was real old. And he looked and said, who are you guys? Your basketball team? And then my brain added this up. Well, he's about 30 years older than us, which means he's from the 60s, where they had the dogs and the hoses and all that. So I flipped. I said, no, motherfucker, we the Black Panthers. And I'm the president, bitch. Turn your motherfucking ass around and fly and mind your motherfucking business. And then he was like this. You know, the rest of the flight, he was horrified. You know, that's how I would react. I would always go to the extreme. And the ultimate extreme was one night we was in Chicago, and we were in a restaurant, and there was a football player named Daryl Stingley. And Daryl Stingley, you know, he had got paralyzed from the neck down by another football player named Jack Tatum. He took a hell of a hit, he got paralyzed, you know, which is a very tragic thing, you know. So Daryl Stingley was happened to come to this restaurant we were in, and in that town he was a celebrity, and he still had, he had a whole bunch of girls with him, you know what I'm saying? But you know, my brother was in there with the tight leather on and all that. Daryl Stingley, you know what I'm saying? He was, he couldn't move, man. You know what I'm saying? He's over here. So just, let me give you an idea of what was going on. We at our table chilling, right? Now the girls with Stingley, they was paying a little bit too much attention to my brother. So we didn't call it hating back then, but Stingley started hating, man. The motherfucker, he's like this. Fuck Eddie Murphy. Fuck that punk ass nigga, shit. I got money. The fuck y'all keep looking at this nigga for? Fuck him. Fuck Buckwheat. Niggas corny anyway. I don't like Beverly Hills Cop. It's going on and on and on and on. Loud, man, like the whole restaurant could hear it. No one is saying anything to Daryl because, you know, as a, you know, as a culture, you know, as a society, it's kind of wrong to step to this guy. You know? But you know, like I told you, man, I make my own rules, man. Fuck that, man. If you're a talking head motherfucker and you acting like you forgot that that's what you are, I'm gonna hold a mirror up and let you see what's going on. I went over there, I told him, I said, look, man, you want me to flip your fucking chair over? Huh? And stomp your mouth? Because that's the only thing that's moving. You want to lose that? Huh? And he looked me in the eye and he seen that I was dead serious. I was going to flip that motherfucker's chair over and stomp his mouth, man. And he got horrified. I said, I'm going back over to my table. If I hear one more peep out of you, man, when I come back over here, I'm a fuck you up, man. Now shut the fuck up. And, you know, then his eyelids was trembling because that's the only thing that can move. And he's sitting there and shit, you know what I'm saying? So I go back to my seat and I sit down. My brother was like, yo, man, why that was messed up, man. I said, you hear him saying anything wrong about you anymore? See, that's how messed up it is. You hear anymore, Eddie Murphy's a bitch, fuck Beverly Hills Cop? The nigga's silent, right? That's how it's supposed to be. He's supposed to be enjoying his meal, shut the fuck up over there and eat his meal. That's what he's doing there. And the girls that was over there, you know, they was quiet and I heard one of them say, Daryl, you're not eating anything. He had lost his appetite. You know what I mean? I mean, I'm sorry I ruined his meal, but he wasn't ruining mine. I'm not hearing it. You know, and it was all stemming from, that's my brother, man. I'm not having it.
I'll tell you how much I appreciate you. You know, this is a new journey for all of us. And being a blended family, you know, we make it the best. And obviously, we won't have like awkward moments, but, you know, we're pushing through. And I can't express how much that I appreciate you, how you look after my kids as your own. And that means so much. So, this stuff that I can't attend if you're there, you know, these videos, when you're rooting for Makai. And, you know, you do the most for Jayla, and she had her moments and everything. And, like, really, words can't express how much I appreciate you. You know, as a being a father, you know, you're like, man, I never have, I don't want to have someone, you know, look after my kids and another man in my kid's life. But, you know, even like my best friend, like, hey, man, this is stuff that you pray for. You know, you want to have a good man in your kid's life. You know, because there's a lot of people who, if it ain't their kids, they don't want to do nothing or be a part of it, you know. But you embrace them and protect them, provide for them. And at the same time, you still allow me just to come over and just chill with them. And, you know, it could be somebody like, nah, I want you over here and this and that, you know. But we have no drama and, you know, we communicate. And again, this is just an early Christmas gift just to show my appreciation for you, you know, and I just want you to know, you know, words can't express, again, you know, so, keep your eyes closed, and you can open up.
Wow.
That's my appreciation right there.
No! Oh.
Oh!
epic. That's my appreciation for you, man. Like I said, I know we talk, it's not even like long talks that we have, but I think we see eye to eye, you know what I'm saying? So it ain't really much need to be said. But again, that's just, again, showing my appreciation, you know. It ain't too much of a word of that, you know. Money can't buy.
This is epic.
What you got going on, so.
Don't get by her shoulder.
appreciate you, man.
Garrett Morgan. Those who survived either of the world wars thanks to a gas mask have Garrett Morgan to thank. Morgan first created the safety hood to help firefighters navigate smoky buildings, later modifying it to carry its own air supply, making it the world's first effective gas masks. He also had the good sense to add a third position to the traffic signal. Yes, there was a time when traffic signals just said indicated, stop, or go, an addition that further reduced automobile accidents. Otis Boykin. Otis Boykin's most notable contribution to science was likely the circuit improvements he made to pacemakers after losing his mother to heart failure, a contribution that has saved countless lives since. But this single improvement was among a long list of achievements. Boykin had 26 patents in his name and is famed for the development of IBM computers, burglar-proof cash register, chemical air filters, and an electronic resistor used in controlled missiles and other devices. Philip Imigwali. Due to cost, Philip Imigwali was forced to drop out of school at age 14. But this didn't stop him from becoming one of the greatest computer pioneers of our time. As an adult, Imigwali began studying nature, specifically bees. The construction of the honeycomb inspired him to rethink computer processing. In 1989, he put this idea to work, using 65,000 processes to invent the world's first supercomputer, able to perform 3.1 billion calculations per second. Elijah McCoy. McCoy was credited for 50 inventions over the span of his career. In an effort to improve efficiency and eliminate the frequent stopping necessary for lubrication of trains, McCoy devised a method of automating the task. In 1872, he developed a lubricating cup that could automatically drip oil when and where needed, vital in avoiding sticking to the track. The lubricating cup met with enormous success and orders for it came in from railroad companies all over the country. It was so popular that when other inventors attempted to steal his idea and sell their own versions of the device, companies were not fooled. They insisted on the authentic device, calling it the real McCoy.
Oh, drop thing.
Hey! Woo!
Get out! Oh!
Get all that! You touch me, nigga!
Shocking claims involved the Playboy magazine founder's alleged fondness for bestiality.
I walked in once and he was to my dog, our dog, and I said, what are you doing? He said, well, dogs have needs. And I said, stop that. Just stop that. And I never left him alone with the dog again. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. I could not believe what I was seeing.
You screamed at a lady, you bugging the fuck out, homie.
Yo,
you bugging out. You got shit all over your face. You bugging out. You high, you smacked. I understand. But you bugging out, homie. I'm not worried about no. I'm not talking about no drugs. I'm saying you high weed. I'm not saying you on no drugs. You don't see how she ran out?
But you don't understand how they treat
me. I understand what you're saying. It's females, homie. Look, females.
So if they females, they need to talk like females. Why is she talking like she gangster?
Yo, you gonna hit the female?
I'm not gonna touch the female.
All right, so why you scaring the female? Let this nigga do that, man. You you somewhere, you supposed to be on a big major platform.
Bro, we good, bro.
But you keep doing, you keep looking all
like, I'm so good, bro. We straight, bro. I'm like, I can tell you, bro, we good, bro.
Your body language.
I'm looking you dead in
your eyes. Your body language is like extra. Extra. Like extra. I understand, but you security. But your body language is extra, like flagrant. Like,
that's just me, bro. It's all love, though, bro. We good.
It's time to kill for our women, time to heal our women, be real to our women.
Help me to put an end to the disrespect and the dishonor of our most valuable resource, the black woman.
You out here snapping. I want you mean. Now listen, let me tell you something. Now this might sting, you rap black, but these are real black queens.
I guess drank each other's blood might mislead people, or like people are imagining us with like goblets and we're like Game of Thrones drinking each other's blood. It's just a few drops, but yes, we do consume each other's blood on occasion for ritual purposes only. It is used for a reason and it is controlled, where it's like, let's shed a few drops of blood and each drink it. He's much more haphazard and hectic and chaotic, where he's willing to just like cut his chest open with broken glass and be like, take my soul. Let me bleed on you.
Yeah, I have to tell the story as clearly as I can, and I'm gonna catch the people that I catch. And then some people, they're just not ready. Sometimes you're just not in the place, no matter how clear it is or what people are saying, to receive information. I remember going to a club with Biggie and him, a guy being out, told the story. Yeah, I just wasn't ready to receive the information.
He thought he was a punk for wanting to go in the club.
Yeah,
not guys wanting
outside,
to go in the club.
He's like, I'm not going in the club. I don't want to deal with that. And I'm like, what? Let me out. I've done dumb shit. Shit was dumb. And I'm telling people, like, yo, I've done dumb shit. Don't do dumb shit.
Truckins.
What?
Trucks.
Trucks?
Yeah, like 18-wheelers.
What?
Restaurants.
We got What's with the 18-wheelers?
What do you mean?
Like, what do you mean you got 18-wheelers?
Trucks, like, that transport, like, packages from stores.
Kodak said that, too. What's with the 18-wheelers? Yeah, how do you get into 18-wheeler transport? Like, what's the
business? You just buy the trucks, and you get contracts from, like, Amazon, or you'll get contracts with, like, Walmart. And so if they need something from this state to that state, whatever it is.
But how do you get into that? Like, that's so random.
You got to have the contracts. Like, you got to have relationships. You got to know people.
Everything's
like, relationship. I probably got, if I got two trucks and my manager got eight trucks and he doing well, I'm going to ask him, like, how you getting that? What you doing?
Mm-hmm.
Like, who you doing it with?
Mm-hmm.
And he'll tell me. Then I'll do it. You know what I'm saying?
What possessed a 15-year-old kid to go into a comedy club or wherever it was that you started and get up on stage?
You remember back, they used to have a show called The Gong Show?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Okay, well, The Gong Show. The Gong Show. that show was so popular, bars started having Gong Show Night. And it was a bar that was having Gong Show Night, and the first prize was $25. And my brother was like, yo, you should go down there and get your... do the gong show and get that money. $25, just go down there and do Stevie Wonder and do that Muhammad Ali impression. You win that. So I went down there and did it, and I won it.
You won the $25?
What is your name again?
Claude Banks.
Claude Banks! It's me, Ray McGibson!
That's the
phrase.
We got 36 cases of booze. That's better than money.
Hey, oh, hey, so come on. We gonna drive home drunk, man? Is that it? Then watch a gamble to watch, right? If it's that serious, why the
Let's go. I don't have no bones about stabbing a nigga. Shit, I wish this spoon was sharp. I'd stab a nigga right now.
When you got a map to New York City, you get back to me. Other than that, get out of here.
What kind of shit is this?
All right, so at the time, it was Devontae had Missy, Timbaland.
Poured a terrible drink. I'm sorry. Yeah, continue.
Missy, Timbaland, Player, Tweet, Sister, Genuine.
And Body Pharrell. Pharrell was probably there too.
All right, so all of them was in the studio. You know what I'm saying? So, you know what I'm saying? He walk in, he's smacking everybody. Genuine, Timbaland, Missy.
What, literally smacking them?
Smacking them.
No,
are we saying Devontae was the R&B show tonight?
Yeah.
This is what we're saying?
Wow.
Is this what we're establishing right now?
This is exclusive shit.
Okay,
right
good,
here.
Please. Right, so I heard this story before.
Almost.
But to hear you say it?
Wait, definitely. This is exclusive.
Let's get back to Devontae the gangster. Is it Devontae? All right, good.
Devontae's just smacking. No,
okay, yeah, so he gets to me. He's walking in the studio just
randomly smacking it.
No, not randomly, with the pit bulls.
Oh.
Damn, he got dogs too?
And with the bodyguards.
He's Wesley Snipes in it?
Yeah.
What, he's saying, you sit your $5 ass down before I make some change? And then smacking you? That's how he's doing it? No, I swear to God I heard this story before. I swear, but I swear I heard this story
some
before.
Crazy shit right here.
All right, so boom, can't be smacking chicks and all that. Boom. Yeah. So he get to me, he like, yo, you cool, you with my brother.
It's okay,
you
know what I'm saying? A couple chicks.
No, I mean, like, you know what I mean? So, but his little cousin come around doing the same thing. He get to me, you know, like, let me smack you. Nigga, you smack me, I'm killing everybody.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I wasn't even up back then. I was slimming, whatever. Right, boom, right. So I go to fight niggas. Whoop. Niggas hit me in the head with a bottle. Boom. Mm. I'm fighting niggas, got the cut over my eye.
Not Devontae.
No, one of the security guards.
But Devontae tried to thug you too?
No, he wasn't. It was his cousin.
His cousin. Oh, God.
So Dalvin.
Devontae.
Yeah. Got a lot going on.
So make a long story short.
I gotta shoot Devontae next time I see him. Because I felt like he tried to ask me for a verse one time. He was way too aggressive. Now I know why. All right, continue. I'm sorry.
So anyway. You know, after that happened, you know, the next day, you know what I'm saying, I'm talking to Missy and Timbaland, like, yo, y'all niggas still fuck with this nigga, you know.
But are you down with Puff at this time, or
I'm not down with
okay.
You know what I'm saying?
But you don't like what's going down.
At all. But right. You in Rochester, my hometown, when I can make that call on niggas.
Mm. Right. Oh, you're in Rochester at the studio?
Yes.
Okay, continue.
You know what I'm saying? Make a long story short, you know what I'm saying? Niggas all left him, Missy, Timbaland, whoa. Thanks to the guy having the fight.
What guy having a fight? Who had a fight?
Oh.
With Devontae?
Yeah.
Squared up with him?
Mm. I mean, you know, fighting whoever I fought. It was like three of them niggas. But thanks to my fight, everybody.
I feel like you won, because that's why you brought me up.
He fought the good fight.
Uh-huh. And thanks to that fight, everybody left. Genuine, Missy, Tweet, Player, everybody
so
left.
So you helped them get out of that situation.
Right. I heard this story before. I'm going to be honest.
You heard this?
I heard Devontae was the show tonight, R&B show tonight. I swear to God,
I heard this story. You know what I'm saying? Wanted to be.
We got to give him the credit. He let them loose.
No, he's letting it out publicly.
But I'm saying, I let everybody out of their shit pretty much.
Right, by you getting in that situation and confronting it.
Because they wouldn't have done it.
Wow.
That's what I'm saying. Yo.
I want a battle! Chill out, nigga. Those mad at y'all niggas, chill out. I want a battle! I said, hey, yo! I'm in the hood with the mop. They call me Mr. Clean. I ride it all through Harlem with the big bean. This is a big scene! You the champ, but that don't mean much. Ice all over the street like ice cream trucks, nigga. That nigga's corny. Oh my God. That nigga's cheating. Hey, cheating, my nigga. Come on. Touch me, my nigga. Got these crazy niggas here, my nigga. How do you, brother?
nigga's burnt, my nigga.
I smack taste out you. I don't even know you, but I can tell you what I hate about you. You got cow titties. Moving around in this wild city. I'm with a mafia that never been around Biggie. I would tell you to throw your guns in the air, but that sounds sticky. You finger diggers, rat. Get a grind up. You don't know the cheat code. You'll have a nigga in a lineup like a free throw, and I ain't even in the game with you. I don't feel that pain with you. I ain't never mass up and do a stain with you. But I will mass up, give an order, and take your food like a PF chain menu you eating with.
Don't touch me, please.
On my block, you'll hear Nas, but you'll probably see Dave East appear. You a fruit, at least a pair. To get to my level, your pin gonna have to go through training for at least a year. Fuck out of here,
man. That nigga's seen as many as fuck out of here.
Right-wing conservative has also been captured in racy photos appearing to wear women's lingerie.
Why do you want the picture of my two-year-old kid?
Why don't you stay away from me?
That doesn't answer my question.
Why don't you stay away?
Why don't you? Why do you want a picture of my?
Everything okay?
So
this guy's assault?
Oh, hold on.
Space out. So he took a picture of my two-year-old daughter. He took several pictures and then stood over here scrolling, and I wanted to know why pictures of my two-year-old daughter.
Okay, any reason for that, sir? Just
she's a cute kid.
Okay, well, you understand
with that.
Okay, so you understand what his concern was, right? Correct.
Actually, I don't.
Okay. Hey, just so it's clear, my concern is that a pedophile would do the exact same thing that you did. You understand?
That might be true.
Yeah. Okay. You're in the same camp as a pedophile.
The total support pouch from Hanes can help you achieve balance. Vista mesh panels for perfect separation and support. Secure. Separated. Supported. Find your balance. Vista total support pouch from Hanes. So secure. I often forget I'm wearing underwear. I still am.
What you gonna do, boy? What you gonna do in here with everybody here, man? What you gonna do? Get your ass up there and get your...
Many white people who mean right and in heart want to do right, but there are so few. If 10,000 rattlesnakes was coming down that aisle now, and I had a door here I could shut, and in that 10,000, 1,000 meant right. 1,000 rattlesnakes didn't want to bite me. I knew they were good. Should I let all these rattlesnakes come down, hoping that 1,000 get together and form a shield? Or should I just close the door and stay safe? So now I'm going to forget the 400 years of lynching and killing and raping and depriving my people of freedom, justice, equality, first fired, last hired, the lowest of low, last respected. And I'm going to look at two or three white people who are trying to do right and don't see the other million trying to kill me. I'm not that big of a fool. And I'm not going to deny it.
Astronomy. And whether you believe astrology to be a true science or not.
Well, I'm actually an amateur astronomer.
Okay.
I've been doing that for a long time.
Yes, sir.
You know, I have a real nice telescope. I have a Celestron SLR, and it's a real nice telescope. You can actually see the rings of Saturn. You can see Jupiter. You can see Mars.
Yeah.
I took a famous picture that's been circulating for years about Mars during the summer. When you take a picture of Mars during the summer, it actually has green, it has blues. Mm. It's not a red planet. Mm. You can see that the ice caps are smaller, which means they've melted. There's a lot of liquid water on the planet. And a lot of those greens, I believe, is vegetation. Mm. You know, and now all the science data is coming back out from NASA now. All of a sudden, press releases are coming out. The soil on Mars is better for growing crops than on Earth. Now they're saying this, there's billions of tons of liquid water on Mars now.
Yeah.
You know what I'm
saying? Can believe that.
And they're also talking about the fact that there's an atmosphere that is equivalent to being like 18,000 feet above sea level, but that's like going to Peru. I'm going to Peru in a few weeks, right? So same thing. You got to acclimate to that height, to that low oxygen, but you can still breathe as long as you stay close to the ground. Once you go higher up, it's going to be very dangerous. But if you're within like 10 feet of the ground, you can actually breathe. You just need to acclimate. So All of a sudden, all this is coming out because why? They're getting ready to, you know, to build an infrastructure up there, in my opinion, and do a breakaway civilization. That's what the whole Elon Musk and all that's on Mars is all about.
They planning on leaving us, people. Please remember where you heard it first, right at the cusp of 2012. They are planning on leaving our motherfucking ass right here. They got space shuttles lined up with GPS navigation on star.
This policy. That policy was to get rid of the population by any means in strategic areas was dealing with food. Also in something called Global 2000 under President Jimmy Carter, you had it when it comes to vaccinations, shots, when it comes to water, when it comes to reproductive services. So all of these areas and arenas were ways to look at how can we reduce the population strategically. Planned Parenthood is one.
Okay.
Vaccinations is another.
Okay.
Fluoridated water is another. The manipulation of nature, herbs, and food, hence the medical marijuana, mm-hmm. hence the GMOs in the food, the cloning of the food, roughly 78 to 80% of the food is genetically modified, destroying the ovaries, destroying the sperm, shrinking the testicles, shrinking the ovaries, creating tumors, creating an inability for people to reproduce, making men sterile, making women infertile, all of these things.
What is y'all doing?
What are y'all doing?
What is y'all doing?
Yes.
And he like a baby to me. Why you? Are you?
That's what I'm doing.
I don't know what you're doing. I just see you snatching up off the. So what? So what's going on then?
He's stealing stuff. If he breaks into your house to steal something.
Nah, man. What, he selling a bag of chips? So y'all treat me like a whole cold blood killer?
Keep walking, dude. You don't even know what you're talking about.
Keep walking. I do. I know what I just came up and see. I know what I just came up and see.
Okay, what'd you see?
I see y'all snatching him off the bike like a grown ass man. And he said it wasn't him. What is y'all doing?
That's crazy.
What is y'all talking about, man?
That's against the law.
What is y'all doing?
You cannot put that.
What is y'all doing? Take the chips. If you stole some chips, I'll pay for them. I'll pay for them. You don't even know where he lives.
You're the higher ramp, you.
Y'all just throwing him in the car.
That's what they do. They come here.
What is y'all doing?
Y'all. I notice y'all really can't stand it whenever I make a post defending black men. There's always a barrage of comments like, we gotta hold them accountable. Don't get me wrong, I'm all for accountability, but when do we not hold black men accountable? It's like every day, every time I get on the internet, someone is always talking about what black men not doing right. As a matter of fact, the only time we do bring up black men is to hold them accountable for the stuff that they not doing. I mean, it's almost like we're letting our personal experiences and the media, first and foremost, dictate how we feel about our own men. Never mind the several instances of black men who are protecting black women. Never mind the black man who pulled a black woman out of a burning building. Never mind the black man who jumped in front of a group of girls and lost his life defending them. Never mind the black men who are taking 12-hour shifts to defend a black woman in their neighborhood. Never mind that the vast majority, over 80% of black men are married to black women. We gotta stop letting the media tell us that our men don't love us and protect us. That's a lie. This country is hell-bent on destroying our men. Let's not help them.
Folks, it's my honor, and it truly is an honor. I've been looking forward to for a while to introduce you.
We just got the freshness in the wrong direction. You know, we just got it all backwards. If we decided to stand up and stand up for you and say, no, you're not gonna say that about him. Or every time something said about him, we said, no, that's not true. That's the first thing I said on television. Oh no, he's a good man. He's the best man there is.
Bother with paying homage to forefathers. See the future like the car show floor models. Both feet in the snow so that my core follows. We don't mourn for the dead, nigga, we pour bottles. Drown sorrows, ocean blue Murcielagos. Started with Similac powder in a baby bottle. Yeah, the formula is warning ya. Crack kills, offerings to the coroner. Kill my eldest brother, nigga, I be damned. Gator at my mama house, welcome to zombie land. A hustler's paradise, a lucky paradise. Down 40, but a streak will have you square by night. Didn't bat an eye at it, kept the poker face. Cause the batter I added had the coca base. When you get to heaven's door, they won't hold the space. If you numb like the flesh on a smoker's face, it's no feeling like your bitch chin chilling right. You in Italian leather and you four wheeling right. You know you up when you can count a quarter million right. And if you down, you can sling it like a pillow fight. I'm a wizard at it, nigga, here's the magic. Make a small town feel I threw a blizzard at it. Get the green from the scale like a lizard had it. Bear witness as I unveil this instant classic. Yes, my God, my God, my God, yes, my God, my God, yes, yeah. The second coming's in the second verse. The first coming still here, so I need a hearse. I got a voodoo doll every time I pin the verse. Not only do they say they feel it, but they say it hurts. No pain, no gain, nigga. They say I'm heating up. Welcome to the flame, nigga. No matter the success, still the same, nigga. I only change when the new body came, nigga. Aerodynamic, roof panoramic. My credit score, let the dealer take full advantage. Paid over stick.
Was not of this world, and there was an otherworldly aspect to Michael Jordan that he did things that nobody else could do.
People think that Jordan gets mythologized out of proportion. In fact, if anything, he becomes underrated over time.
I think Michael Jordan had the perfect body. It's long, it's lean, he can run,
yeah,
he
agree with you.
Everything was perfect.
The guy's the best defensive player in the league. He's the best offensive player, and he's the best competitor.
And then you couple that with all of that athleticism, then his confidence skyrocket.
By Rivers, and now Jordan with some words for Rivers.
He talks a lot of trash, and he had all, everything came together.
He was the first to wear the number 23.
You take this for granted now, but just the dunking. And just him being in the slam dunk contest, wearing his shoes. Everybody wanted those shoes. Everybody wanted to see the dunk. That's like all you cared about.
The sneakers sent people into a frenzy. Sit back, I'm about to, sit back, I'm about to begin. Sit back, I'm about, sit back, I'm about to begin. To do so many things.
Ball head, tongue wag.
Flying through the air with your tongue out in front of the baddest motherfucking basketball players in the world.
Nobody that I've seen had the type of mental toughness that Michael Jordan had.
He was born with killer instinct because you can't learn it. You can't create it. You can't teach it. You can't coach it. You're either built that way or you're not.
It was a wrap for everyone in the league. Didn't matter who you weren't getting anything when Jordan was around.
It moved Larry Bird to say, that's not Michael Jordan. That's God disguised as Michael Jordan.
The fact that he could fly is really magical on television. And it brought people who were not basketball fans in just at the sheer majesty and grace of his movement.
I got it open! Good heavens, man! Great Scott, we've discovered the fountain of all knowledge of Egypt in the entire world, you... Do you realize the importance of this moment, Smedley?
Yes, sir, I do.
Do you see the brilliance, the untold years?
I see it, sir.
This is medicine! Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Father. You slave. Look! What is this?
See? Says, cannot. This is the elixir of life, sir.
The elixir of life?
The cure for all diseases. Wait, let's see here. Wait,
give it to me.
The inscription on the bottom.
Give it to me. Give it.
Open at other end.
Lummox.
This can't be, man.
What?
You know what this is?
What is it, Buna?
It's the Book of Life. In the beginning, when man arrived on Earth, the black gods did leave their spacecraft, and they walked, and they named the beast of the sea and the animals of the land.
Heavens.
And man in his blackness did walk the Earth, making medicine.
Medicine?
They discovered type. These were all black people, goddamn! Wait a minute! Yeah. Listen, there ain't nothing here about Whitey. This is ours, Jack. Wait till the brothers hear this.
Buna.
I'm gonna get this book out of here, baby. This tells me real tea.
Buna, control yourself. Control yourself, don't you see?
What you mean, Jack? Look at this here. Black people discovered the, started the music and the brain surgery back in the year 3 BC.
Yes, of course, Buna.
Man, they was getting down. This is it, brother.
Yes,
everybody gonna know about this. This book. We can change the history. Civilization will be changed.
By all means.
Yeah, this is gonna be it.
Get the bulldozers. There's nothing here.
But.
Shut up. Good heavens, time for tea, eh?
What?
Because there's a whole lot of illusions about Africa's relationship with other people in the world. There's a whole lot of illusion about our relationship to the religions in the world. And these belief systems that had its origin in Africa, all of them, and there is no exception, turned on African people. I said there is no exception. And there's one thing you have to get through your mind and keep it. Nothing that ever came from the European mind was meant to do anything but facilitate European domination of the world. And I said there's no exception. Everything that was brought into this continent, everything, every idea, every so-called religion was meant to dominate and to control. The Arabs had no illusions about it. The Europeans had no illusions about it. You were the ones with the illusions. And yet every element that went into the making of every major religion in the world started in Africa. Why is it that you are so naive, you let people redress something that you invented, sell it back to you, and enslave you through it?
Because the sun was abundant, it provided the sun people with abundance. And so sun people developed a psychology that was based on sharing. Sun people developed a psychology based on taking care of other people. Sun people developed a psychology of love and collectivism. Why? They didn't need to steal nothing because the sun would give it back if it ran out. They didn't need to control no resources because the sun would give them more if it exhausted itself. These people lived communally. They didn't have to lock their doors. They didn't have to worry about stealing because they were people under the sun. The most egalitarian human beings you can ever find. They never learned to be scared. They never learned to hate. They never learned to harm people. If they wanted it, they prayed for it. And most of the time, they didn't have to pray for it because it was already there. The sun people. They lived in harmony with nature. The sun people. They believed that men should be with women and women should be with men. The sun people. They had no concepts of feminism. They had no concepts of homosexuality. They had no concepts of anything that was anti-nature. Because the sun people were a nature-based people. But there was another group of people called ice people. They didn't have no damn sun. Truth be told, they didn't have no damn soap either. It always was cold. Nothing grew from the trees. Nothing sprouted from the ground. They lived in caves, under rocks, and in the soil that they did have, it never produced anything because it wasn't nutrient rich. Developed the psychology of always having to manipulate other people to get what they needed because they did not eat unless they stole it from someone who had. They developed a psychology of trickery because the only thing that they could provide was what they could hoist from others. In fact, ice people had no system of family because they didn't know whether they would live another day or not. And if they got too hungry, they didn't go hunting because there was nothing to hunt. They had to kill and eat each other. Ice people could not live in harmony with nature. Why? Because nature did not provide for them. How do you expect me to respect the sun? The sun never gave to us like it gave to the sun people. How do you expect me to respect the moon? You tell me to reverence the hurricane and the tornado and the thunderstorm. We can't, because the forces of nature never blessed the people of the ice. And so one day, the ice people wandered out of their caves and they came into the land of the sun people. And they walked right up and said, look at this shit here. They got diamonds in the damn water. Kids is climbing up eating coconuts. And the ice people got jealous of the sun people. They said, we've been suffering like this 5,000 years. And these people got the audacity to be living like this? Oh, hell no. Guess what we gonna do? We gonna take and steal and kill and manipulate, and we not gonna feel sorry for none of these sun people because they never had it like we had it. And we gonna give them a taste of what the hell we had to go through. In fact, we gonna make their hell 50 times worse than ours. But the sun people didn't understand it because your heart was so good and so pure. When you saw the ice people, they came in, smelling like dog mess, you gave him some black soap and took him to the river to wash his ass. And when he was done washing at the river, you brought him some shea butter. And you know how y'all love shea butter. Yeah, strawberry shea butter, pineapple shea butter, rum raisin shea butter. You gave him a haircut. You taught the women how to take care of themselves when they monthly came. You treated them like family. And guess what? The better you treated them, the more jealous they became of you. In fact, they began to have a contempt of the sun people. Because after all, people without anything hate to feel indebted to somebody who can give them something. So the more you helped, the more they strategized the hurt, and they took over the land of the sun, and they still taking over the land of the sun. And the ancestors sent me here today to tell you some people in here, stop acting like you come from the goddamn ice. You sun people, we got a certain way of living, a certain way of acting, a certain way of feeling, a certain way of praying, and a certain way of making. And we don't let nobody come and tell us how to operate our communities. If you're not careful, these ICE people will take so much that you will have to move to the ICE. Brothers and sisters, I know we've been raised not to hate. And I want you to continue not to hate. But please don't confuse not hate with not accepting the reality that there are people who exist who are nothing like you, want nothing to do with you, and will kill their own children to get rid of you.
Who protects the interests of this group? Who really protects the interests of this group? The ones who enslaved you are protecting your interests, even if they free you. That's like a rapist keeping you in prison for 10 years, raping you every day for 10 years. You insane with it. Then the 11th year, he says, I reached an epiphany. I was wrong. I shouldn't have did that. You're free to go. Now you're free to go. Go where? Free. Now here we are. Crazy. Deranged. Walking around. Being raped for 300 years. Now you're free. And your head is going, woo. But here's the point. You were God to begin with. This is what we forgot. This is what we forgot. You were God to begin with. So you did get beat, raped, punched, lynched, burned. But what happened? You're still here.
I want every white person in this room who would be happy to be treated as this society in general treats our citizens, our black citizens. If you, as a white person, would be happy to receive the same treatment that our black citizens do in this society, please stand. You didn't understand the directions. If you white folks want to be treated the way blacks are in this society, stand. Nobody's standing here. That says very plainly that you know what's happening. You know you don't want it for you. I want to know why you're so willing to accept it or to allow it to happen for others.
You remember what he said?
Yes, I do. Call me a racist.
Well, what he said was, George Bush doesn't care about black people.
That's because he's a racist. And I didn't appreciate it then, and I don't appreciate it now. It's one thing to say, you know, I don't appreciate the way he's handled his business. It's another thing to say this man's a racist. I resent it. It's not true. And it was one of the most disgusting moments of my presidency.
This is from the book. I faced a lot of criticism as president. I didn't like hearing people claim that I lied about Iraq's weapons of mass destruction or cut taxes to benefit the rich. But the suggestion that I was racist because of the response to Katrina represented an all-time low.
Yeah, still feel that way as you read those words. Felt them when I heard them, felt them when I wrote them, and I felt them when I'm listening to them.
You say you told Laura at the time it was the worst moment of your presidency.
Yeah.
I wonder if some people are going to read that, and they might give you some heat for that. And the reason is this.
I don't care.
Well, here's the reason. You're not saying that the worst moment in your presidency was watching the misery in Louisiana. You're saying it was when someone insulted you because
of
it.
I also make it clear that the misery in Louisiana affected me deeply as well.
Drapetomania. You are now watching Drapetomania.